Hi, I'm Paul Roberts, Artsy1, and we've finished our planing and smoothing, and now we go in and work on the details a little bit. Now, once we get into having everything, the shape and the thickness that we want, there's some things where we have to go back in and additively work on, like any little small raised sections, like the eyebrows or different wrinkles or different things like this. We take small pieces of clay and we add them back on and we sculpt them in. Now, when we first put them on, they're gonna be a little bit crude. But what you really want is you just want to concentrate on getting the placement and the thickness right when you put them on. Then you can sculpt with your tools and work them out to be what you want them to be. So then the next phase is going to be where we go around the whole sculpture and we just kind of warm it up a bit. This is not raking, this is kind of like just making sure that the things that you had that were kind of crude and harsh are just kind of a little more subdued. Now, you're not gonna do this until you know you've got your planes right, you know you've got all your bulk areas in the right spaces, things like that. Here you have too much detail and extreme contrast of the detail, and you want to lighten it. You wanna have it there, but you wanna lighten it before you do the final sculpt. So, kind of like one of my friends said, the Bob Ross thing. You know, this is where you get your paint on your lake, and then you go back and forth like this, and you smooth it. So that's kind of one of the ways you do that. Another thing too, you really want to get your picture right in your hand at this point, and you really want to, once you've got it smoothed down, and even before you've smoothed it, you want to go back and forth, a little bit of smoothing, a little bit of sculpture. You want to just make sure that all the lines are exactly where the lines need to be. You're almost drawing on it. You're almost drawing out like with a pencil. You make sure, is that line the same distance from that line, the same distance from that line, is that line a little bit bigger? That kind of thing. And you kind of like sketch your marks on it like this. And you eat away at the clay a little bit on the indentation portions, and you put a little bit of clay on wherever you want it to be a little bit thicker. So you kind of like do your rough sketch now of the details in the marking tool like that. Just really roughly in there like that. And then you soften it up. And you can do that back and forth a bunch of times until you have kind of what you need. And then you go, again, this is not like raking. You're not gonna take as much off. You're gonna move the material around until it softens it up. Going around my little valleys. It's almost like pointillism. You know, like some of those famous impressionist painters do. You're almost massaging every single portion of the detail of the entire sculpture, even the planes. You're almost massaging it with pointillism. And anything that's sticking out is gonna get its head chopped off. This is the phase where you're eliminating things as you go. Once you've covered this whole thing with this pointillism detail type thing, anything that was like wrong gets smoothed in or chopped off. But you really want to make sure before you get into too much of this stuff right now that all your dimensions are what you want them to be. Okay? To the form underneath. And you want to do the exact same thing on the other side. And you want to check that it's in balance. You don't want this side to be thicker and that side to be not as thick. So that's a very important thing to do before you get to this phase. This isn't the finalization phase. This is the finalization phase of getting the clay in place in even small areas. That's what this is right now, because we're still gonna go really rough. Your tennis is like stone, you know? This would be like a chisel going across it like this. Now, I know we already talked about smoothing this out, so you say, well, this is already smoothed out. This is already a plane. Yeah, that's true, it is. But when I go and I add some details and things like this, depending on how good I had planned for this ahead of time, I may find it sticks out too much or something like that. And I might have to go back in and reconsider my planes and feather them into one another. And so I'm actually like, say I like this way this comes down across here like this. I want to make sure that this plane like this hits up with those things properly. And as I'm going along like this, if one of them's sticking up a little bit, it'll get hit down. So if I want those wrinkles in the same plane as this, once again, even though I smoothed earlier, now I'm smoothing again because that'll take that down. And then I can go back to where I'm doing this and where I'm heating it up. You really have to heat it up for this because it's so hard clay, and this is just a brush that you have to heat up the clay in order for it to accommodate it properly. And then just go in there and just say, okay, well, these aren't supposed to be just gouges. They're supposed to be flesh, you know, underneath, you know, making the fabric go. And so you can't have angles. You got to have, like, this is smoothly going around his skin. So I'm going to take off all my areas that indicate that I made a mark. We don't want to make this look like it was sculpted out of clay or anything like that. I'm going to make it look like the real thing. So anytime I see anything, it looks like, oh, that looks like a tool did that. I want to get away from that. I don't want anything to look like a tool made any of this. And go and make the whole thing now in a sketching fashion. So that when you come back to it and you do the final smoothing process, the sketch indicates what you wanted your planes to be and what you wanted your details to be. So when you go back in with the finalization process, you're not guessing anymore. You can make some refinements, but your sketch indicates what it wants. And like I say, be looking at what the details are. You should already have the details all to scale, all to thickness, all to balance at this point before you go any further. So now I'm kind of like saying, okay, I think this has like a thrusting feel. This is this great big muscular thing coming down. So I'm kind of in my sketch, I'm going to kind of go, I'm not actually doing much here, but I'm showing what I want for my finalization. How do I want my thrusting feel to be? I'm indicating, like, whenever I get into one of these little crevices here, well, there's no thrust there. That's indicating that I want a little bit of a roundness to come out of there. So I changed my direction. I changed my technique. And you say, well, why can't you just go in there like this and go, and you can. But what happens is it's not sensitive. It'll give you a smoother surface. And you say, well, that's better than what you have. It's not sketchy. That's true. But you'll lose the ability to detail each one of those nuances. If you do the detailing of the nuances first, then when you finally do the finalization process, the detailing of the nuances will show through. The noodling's going to guide my way. The noodling's going to show me, what was I thinking when I was working on this? Which way did I think it needed to go? And so I'm being guided by my sketch as I work. So the sketch is very, very crucial. Just like the masters, they always did the sketches of the paintings or the sculptures before they ever did the sculptures. Because they weren't making it up as they went. They might have been fluid in their technique, and they might have been like honing in on the beauty and the color and the texture, but they weren't making it up. They were actually following what the planning they had done ahead of time. And you want to do that too. I can go around and follow each thing around as I go and make sure that everything has a nice, you know what a French curve is? You know, a French curve kind of continues to accelerate and decelerate as it goes in a very smooth pattern. It's just not chunky. You want to do that same thing. You want to go like, okay, I'm going to start down in this little crevice here. I'm going to go do 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 do. You want to be sensitive to the thing all the way around the whole thing. Now, you could, like I said, you could take a rake and you could do that, but sometimes you lose the sensitivity until you do the sketch first. So you want to go around every single form, and I'm just working on this small area because this is not about do what I do. This is about how do you do it, and then you do what you do. So I'm skipping a whole lot of things on this video that you're not seeing, like all the work into the form. But I'm showing you what I'm thinking about when I'm doing it. If this isn't just a great big thing that goes down like this, and it's around here, and it's around here. The form actually changes as it comes around. And you want to work that form as it comes around. And you want to be aware of it from every angle now. And we're not working just front and side and back anymore because we know we got our proportions right now. We're not doing front, side, top, and back anymore. You know, the animators at Disney, they're constantly drawing upside down. I bet you didn't know that. Maybe you did. If you went over to the animation studio, they're constantly drawing upside down and turning it around all the time. You want to do that too. You want to say, now I'm looking at the form in 3D. I'm saying, do I like everything about that right there? Remember, I established these planes a long time ago, so I'm not questioning the plane any longer. Now I'm questioning, as I go around that plane, do I like the fullness of the understanding of the plane, the way I like I see it? And also, I've got these little marks that I did in my sketch before I started this video. A lot of times I'll do like this to see where I'm going to do my marks first. If you look at the things here, there's a lot of underlying understanding of musculature. And I want to look for that in there every time I can. this is like an indent in the plane that I was already working on. That if you didn't have it there, it'd be fine, it'd be nice and smooth and everything. But this is suggestive of musculature underneath. And by leaving this out, not having it there at all, well, the sculpture lacks a lot more form. Like, I really liked the Batman Returns cowl because it was so smooth it had hardly any form except for those great big eyebrows and those great big temples from Michael Keaton's inspiration. But this one, the reason I like this one is it's got so much indication of what's going on underneath with his muscles and everything. And so we don't want to take this and just say, let's make this just a flat area. It could do that. But we don't want to do that. We want to have planes within planes. That's what I'm doing. And I'm indicating, well, how do I think that rounds out with my noodling here? It's more important to listen to what I'm saying and be thinking about these things than being able to see them. Because you're not going to replicate what I'm doing. You're going to do it your own way. If you've got everything ready, your additive sculpture should be really, really minimal at this point. You shouldn't be doing major changes now. If you're doing major changes now, there's a good chance you've got major things wrong. That's why I said you want to develop the whole thing all at once. So, now, I'm still clunky on the front. I'm a lot more clunky than I'm going to be, but I haven't taken everything off yet, so I'm leaving the clunkiness there, knowing that this cowl is just below the surface now. So, once again, I went around this, and I softened everything up, and now all that clay's on there, just where I want it to be, okay? And this is a great way to do it, too. Without heating it up, I can create a lighter rub texture. And that's going to show me where all my highs are. It's almost like dry brushing. By not heating it. Heating it will slick it. By rubbing it without heating it, I get a dry brush texture. It shows me my form, especially in the detail areas. I'm only going to look for the detail areas. I'm going to iron them out. I'm going to make sure they match on both sides. I'm going to make sure that if I were to finish, once I get those detail areas, I'm going to make sure that they'd be finished the way I'd want them to be, and where I'd want them to be, and how thick I'd want them to be. And as I'm going along, this dry brush area indicates where I've been. I like to always change and modulate my entire surface so that every time I take it a new cross across the whole thing, I can tell, well, what am I doing this time? Where was I? Why did I leave this in this state? Have I touched this state? Have I gone past this state? What have I done to it? If I'll go around, I'll make my texture on the surface of the thing different every time. Every time I do a cross, I'm aware of what I'm achieving. I'm looking at every little divot. I'm looking at the way this little gully goes into here. When does it upswing back up again? Where? Is that going to go right down through here? Is that the biggest dip? Yeah, I can see it from this angle really well to see whether it is. I might want to draw it over here, but I want to look at it in foreshortened perspective like this and see if I like the way that it's going in and feathering into this plane. So that's what I'm going to do with my noodling. So I hope I've explained enough to, well, why did I smooth it before, and why am I noodling again now? When I smoothed it before, again, when I'm trying to explain this, I smoothed it before to make sure that I had my plans right, and I had my form so I could work with it. Now I'm doing the details, and so I'm going over top of what I had smoothed before, and I'm working on those detail areas. These areas right here, along here, they're too extreme probably right now, but it's very important to draw them in and understand them in their extremeness, and get them the way I want it, and then soften it. And I'd like to say thank you to Mike, DT. Thanks to this picture, I'm much more convinced of what's probably going on in the shape of this. And thanks to this picture, I'm more convinced of what's going on in the shape of this. I was gonna just wing it, but when you're trying to make it as accurate as possible, it's always nice, those people that help you out. Tony got me a good start. Mike got me some things that nobody else has helped me with. I appreciate that, guys. Because, well, you're already my bud, so I'm going to give you a deal on this as we go through it anyway. But that's just an extra thing that makes me appreciate you. Makes worth doing what I'm doing. Also, I have this light up here. I don't know if I mentioned this before. When I'm looking at this, it's not the best for you. I could be standing showing you what I'm doing if I was standing over there. But like I say, what I'm telling you about is more important than showing you what I'm doing, because you're going to do it yourself. The reason why I've got this here is, as I'm looking at this, I'm rotating this, I can see the highlights on everything as it falls. I can see the dips going to shadow. Things like that. I can see the slickness of the clay or the roughness depending on if I wanted to make a new surface. Depending where I'm at on my surface, whether I'm in a smoothing part or a rubbing part. So that's why that light's there. I recommend doing that too. A 3/4 view light like that is good. A lot of people use it from the top. It's kind of just what you think works best for yourself. Also, feel your form. Oh, that's a great way to do it. I haven't mentioned that yet. When you get to this point, you can feel your form. Everything should mirror. If I put my hands there, places I can't see, pretend I'm blind, if anything stands out like an anomaly, I can do a small amount of adjustment right now, just by feeling, not even looking at what I'm doing. If anything stands out like an anomaly, notice it, adjust it. If you can do it just like this, then leave it. If not, go and hone in on it and say, well, why was that different? So that's important. Feel the form. My hands can actually tell what's going on in a lot of instances better than trying to get above something and eyeballing it. Another technique I normally use, and I'm doing this mostly with photography right now, I'm reversing my photos of what I've got to look at the other side, but a lot of times I'll have a mirror over on the other side, and so when I'm working on this side, I can see the other side while I'm working on this side. That's very important to do. I'm doing it mostly with photos right now. So there you go, just some things to think about as you're working along. However, like I say, if you don't have aesthetic values, an acute sensibility of aesthetic values, then that's going to take you the longest time, because you don't know what you want to tell yourself to do. How do you tell someone how to get a shape right? That's what takes the time. That's why I advise people, if they just want to dress up like Batman, just buy something that a really hardcore, dedicated fan has done. Get involved in the Batman community if you care that much. If you're not going to become an artist and sculptor, don't delude yourself. You can take a lot of time and money trying to craft these costumes. So, I say to these people, I say, you know, the shape's all wrong. I mean, that's hard to say that, but if you can't do it, I'll never get it. It's like, you know, I don't watch this show. I hate reality TV, but American Idol, I think. Yeah. I made an exception for Suzanne Boyle. Boy, she was the best, man, on that other one. Somebody's Got Talent, I forget what it's called. Man, every once in a while you get like a highlight like that, and it makes a whole show worthwhile. What a waste. But, I mean, you want to not be mean to the person. You want to say, look, man, it doesn't look like it. And you have to say that to them, or they'll believe they can sing. You know? If you don't have aesthetic understanding, I remember one of my friends one time, I won't mention his name, I said the worst thing I could possibly say to him, and I hate it because he was one of my friends, but I had to say it. He was working by my side, and I was trying to teach him things. He had trouble with symmetry and stuff like that. He didn't know the basic rules of drawing. And he asked me, well, what do I need to do? What's wrong? Why can't I get this? I said, well, it's because you have no skills. Oh, man, I could have killed myself because, man, it was the worst thing to say. You know who you are. You laugh about it now, but, you know, we had a good relationship. It was fun. But you have to have skills. You have to have aesthetic sensibilities that spend a lifetime developing. If you don't, you're going to maybe get to somewhere that you can live with, but I wouldn't necessarily advise doing this unless you're having the time of your life, because you think, oh, I'm going to do it because I'm going to save money. I'm going to, you know, I'm going to make a costume for myself. You're not going to save any money. By the time you're done with this, you're going to have spent way more time and energy and money than you ever would have if you just bought something. And that's the truth. I've been through this so many times, so many ways. This is for you if you just absolutely have to do it. This is to get you going. Paul Roberts signing out. Artsy1. Talk to you again very soon. Have a good one.